and that is, if I think it's so important that audiences actually understand structures, right? If I say the problem with Tailspin is that there's an interesting structure and the audience didn't understand it, well, how can audiences understand systems? So how many of you have played SimCity? All right, well, that's pretty good, right? So you're familiar with this, right? This is me playing SimCity Classic in the DOSBox emulator, right? The system always gives feedback to my experiments. And some of them are like, you know, this. You can see this sort of animation that says, okay, it looks like traffic's kind of getting congested on these roads. But sometimes it's a little more direct, right? So like up here, it's like residents demand a stadium, right? In case you didn't figure it out, the city you have built needs a stadium soon. And then it can get very direct, right? Traffic in the city is expanding. The commuters are getting militant. Highway shootings are on the rise. Either build more roads and rails or get a bulletproof limo. Right. So I'm not going to necessarily read a couple of quotes here from Will Wright, but I'm going to put them up. Right. And Will Wright is very explicit that up, at least up until Spore, this has really been the design philosophy that he was trying to pursue. Right. How do you create something that is a simulation you can play, and where playing well is about building a model of the simulation in your head, and then your activity of play is actually engaging more and more deeply with that computational system. So in some ways, we might say this is the opposite of the ELISA effect, right? The ELISA effect is about obscuring what's going on under the surface. But I'd say there's actually something quite similar at the outset, right? What's that similar thing at the outset? It's expectations, right? So Wright argues you can't just dump the simulation on a player. They won't get it. It's this huge system. What you do is think, what's a simpler mental model? What is their expectation, right? What is your expectation of being a city planner? What is your expectation of therapy, right? And so this is something that both the ELISA effect and the SimCity effect harness. So both of them work on expectation at first, but I'd say that play causes them to diverge. SimCity is designed to transition players through experimentation and feedback from their initial assumption to their understanding of its simulated city, whereas ELISA is aimed to keep the front up until it breaks down, but never transition you to a new model of what conversation or therapy might mean. And as I was just saying, SimCity is really about exposing this interesting model and making it the center of gameplay. And obviously the same, or at least obviously to me, the same is true of The Sims, right? My mental model of what suburban life is like is not one in which I need to constantly pay attention to the state of my bladder, right? But The Sims makes it very clear that that is actually one of the things I need to do. It transitions me from my expectation of what suburban life might mean to its model of what suburban life might mean. And I think it's undoubtedly the case that these are the most successful computer characters we have ever had, right? Both cultural impact and just in terms of raw dollars, right? This is the best-selling PC game of all time, and it is a fiction with no plot about essentially, suburban life is a game you can't win, right? It's amazingly avant-garde on some level. And so I'd say, you know, we can expand the possible in digital media by expanding the set of playable models. And I think that's part of what's been interesting about Wright's work, is he's gone in and taken things like James Forrester's urban dynamics simulations and said, we can use this as a new kind of playable model. So I've been interested in that kind of work, in exploring what new playable models might be. So for example, I've tried to use existing processes, in this case sort of simple n-grams or Markov chains, to create a new kind of play that basically is a play of textual transformation. Now I'd say part of what I learned in writing this book is that these pieces don't do what I hoped they would do, in part because they don't do enough to expose the underlying model to the audience. They generate pieces of n-gram text from which you make selections, but they aren't constantly showing the branching through Markov chain space that I think might be a little closer to the actual goals we were after. And I've recently moved to UC Santa Cruz basically to collaborate with a group on crafting new processes for new experiences. So I'm now at the Expressive Intelligence Studio at UC Santa Cruz's Computer Science Department. I've been there for a year. And there are five faculty who basically take this as their primary focus. So Michael Mateus and Jim Whitehead were there when I arrived, and we've just hired Arnav Jala from ITU Copenhagen and Marilyn Walker from Sheffield. And we have both a computer science PhD and an MFA that we have students as part of. But part of the reason I even mention this is so that you will tell interested undergrads, because right now I'm working with 18 PhD students in this group and one MFA student. So I'm hoping you will convince some promising undergrads to apply to the MFA program this fall. And finally, because I like my talks to have kind of a round trip, I do want to talk briefly about one of the projects we're doing there. This is one with PhD student Anne Sullivan and Michael Mateus as a faculty collaborator. So we're trying to make another borrowing from tabletop role-playing game quests into computer role-playing game quests. So basically create quests as playable structures that are defined by goals rather than a milestone task list. So the way Anne talks about this is if the quest for the Holy Grail was in a computer role-playing game, it would be a quest to kill a named enemy and take it off their corpse, right? Rather than a goal, like, oh, hey, we need to figure out where the Holy Grail is, right? And then we're also trying to work on things like authoring support to make multiple solutions easier. Anne went down and worked with, say, the people who were doing Vanguard for Sony Online, where they initially had a lot of goals to have multiple solution quests. And they basically said, using our current tools, multiple solutions are exponentially harder, not just double the effort. And so part of it is a kind of tools for supporting creativity play. But then there's also obviously some work we're doing in the underlying logical representation. So this is my last slide, because I'm contractually obligated to show you my book cover, and also because I just want to summarize by saying authors can express ideas through computational processes. Audiences can experience these ideas through play. I think that's part of what makes play so powerful. It's a way of building models in our heads of ideas that come from other people. And then I say critics can express can examine the ideas that processes express and their connections to histories, economies, and so on. But none of this is a given. All of this is just my hope for our field. So thank you.